1 Kings 19:1 says, "And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life, and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die, and said, It is enough now, O Lord. Take away my life, for I'm not better than my fathers." Heavenly Father, I pray you'd bless the reading of your word, the preaching to follow. God, let it be exactly what we stand in need of and what hurting and hungry hearts need to hear this hour. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. One of the world's finest preachers lived from 1834 to 1892. But what most people don't know is that frequently in his ministry, he was plunged into severe depression due in part to gout, but also for other reasons. In a biography of this preacher, Arnold Dallimore wrote, "What he suffered in those times of darkness we may not know. Even his desperate calling on God brought no relief. There are dungeons, this preacher said, beneath the castles of despair." This depressed preacher was none other than the great Charles Haddon Spurgeon himself. Many years ago, a young Midwestern lawyer suffered from such deep depression that his friends thought it best to keep all knives and razors out of his reach. He questioned his life's calling and the prudence of even attempting to follow it through. During this time, he wrote, "I'm now the most miserable man living. Whether I shall ever be better, I cannot tell. I awfully forebode I shall not." That depressed lawyer also had a name that you might recognize, Abraham Lincoln. Depression is probably the most common problem that counselors, whether secular or biblical, will face. People everywhere seem drawn to depression and unaware of how to deal with it. To tell you how prevalent it is, a Google search of the word depression as of October the 8th, 2019, reveals more than 1.1 million hits. It's estimated that nearly 20 million adults in America suffer from depression, and I can tell you from 22 years of pastoring and 23-plus years of traveling and evangelism that many of those 20 million depressed people are members of good local churches. So what is this awful monster that so many people face? Well, the Encyclopedia Britannica defines depression as a neurotic or psychotic disorder marked by sadness, inactivity, difficulty in thinking and concentration, a significant increase or decrease in appetite and time spent sleeping, feelings of dejection and hopelessness, and sometimes suicidal tendencies. Hippocrates, thousands of years ago, called it melancholia. Researchers from the University of Texas called depression the common cold of mental health. A somewhat bizarre website defines depression as the denial of God. I saw a Facebook post recently claiming that anyone who's depressed is sinning by that depression, since it is, in their words, always a lack of faith. I would really like to do some fist-to-mouth dental work on that one, but I'll refrain from doing so. You see then that there's no blanket one-size-fits-all definition of depression. We're dealing with a problem that doesn't even have a common, universally accepted identity. Fortunately, we have the Bible, God's Word, and though the Bible does not use the word depression, it clearly shows us an example of someone who any counselor, secular or Christian, would have to classify as depressed. So looking at this example, we can learn a bit about God's definition of depression and how to defeat it. Amazingly, the clearest example in Scripture of somebody battling depression is none other than the one we just read about in our text a moment ago, the great prophet Elijah. It's evident from this episode in his life that depression can be biblically defined this way: a period of extreme hopelessness characterized by erratic behavior and irrational thought. Elijah wasn't just worried, he was hopeless. He didn't see any light at the end of the tunnel. He also ran from a fight which was completely out of character for him. He just won a victory against 850 false prophets and called down fire from God out of heaven, yet he then turned and ran from a woman. That's why we say that depression is characterized by irrational behavior. Any man that whips 850 false prophets then runs from a woman is exhibiting irrational behavior. Someone may stop sleeping, or they may sleep all the time. They may quit a job or work 120 hours a week nonstop. They may withdraw from friends, family, or society in general. It can be about anything, but a person who is depressed will normally exhibit some erratic behavior if you're perceptive enough to see it. Elijah then demonstrated irrational thought. He ran for his life, and then what did he beg for? He begged to die. Ran for his life, but begged to die. Elijah was absolutely depressed. But the good news is that he overcame that depression, and God gave us a record of it. Because of that, we can read the map that can lead people out of depression. I want to preach for the next few moments on this subject, defeating depression. Now, before I do, please let me issue a disclaimer. I'm not one of those people who tells others that professional counseling or medication is never necessary. The brain is just like any other part of the body. It can malfunction. So sometimes those things are necessary. I am, though, one who says and believes that a great deal of it can be survived or made better or even beaten by following the path that Elijah took. So number one, let me say this. When battling depression, deal as much as possible with the physical and behavioral causes that make the body and therefore the mind as well not operate the way that God designed it. When a secular counselor deals with a person that's depressed, the term chemical imbalance will almost inevitably arise. That's why many secular counselors immediately jump to treating depression with medication, sometimes of the type that are hooking people by millions onto a lifelong dependency. It's ironic, the war on drugs rails against crack cocaine and marijuana, LSD, methamphetamines, and heroin, but gives a pass to many things that are just as addictive in many cases. The difference is that a doctor, rather than a dealer, is the recipient of the profits. Now, as I alluded to a moment ago, here's where many fundamental Christian counselors make a mistake. They hear the term chemical imbalance thrown about so consistently, and so they shout to the hilltops, there's no such thing as a chemical imbalance. Well, I disagree. The human body designed by God is loaded with chemicals. The human brain designed by God is loaded with chemicals, and it's just as possible for something to go wrong with the chemicals in your body and brain as it is for something to go wrong with your heart or lungs or kidneys. So I don't agree with people who say there's no such thing as a chemical imbalance, but I also don't agree with people who immediately dope people up to fix that chemical imbalance without ever even considering trying something less risky. Both things are wrong. Both ignore how God designed our body and mind. Again, I'm not saying there's never a time for medication. I am saying point blank, though, that medication, which should be a very last resort, is almost always used as the first resort instead. I'm saying that many doctors and psychiatrists also try to treat spiritual and behavioral problems with drugs rather than actually getting to the heart of the matter. I'm saying that we live in the medication generation, and a lot of people who are doped up on addictive medications probably have better options available to them. So when someone comes battling depression, you can help them begin to deal with that chemical imbalance, if that's what's causing it, by having them deal with any physical and behavioral causes that keep the body chemicals out of whack. Let's look at several things from this episode in the life of Elijah. Notice verse 5, 1 Kings 19:5. When Elijah was battling depression, he got some rest. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. Twice Elijah slept. This idea of restoring a proper amount of sleep and rest is essential in dealing with depression, especially if that depression has been caused or exacerbated by exhaustion. Friends, Elijah was exhausted. He had just run for his life. He was in the wilderness. He was too tired not to be depressed. You ever been there? It's amazing how intricately God designed the human body. For years, people have been sleeping and resting, not even really knowing all the good that it does. The human body is literally a chemical-producing factory, and the time it does its best work is when the body is getting rest and sleep. Your body produces scores of helpful chemicals, both in the body and the brain, when your body's at rest. If you want to treat a chemical imbalance, this is an excellent place to start. God knew this, and he told us so over and over again. Listen to this, Genesis 2, 2 and 3. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he'd made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he'd made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he rested from all his work which God created and made. Did God need rest? No, he's the omnipotent God, but he showed us a pattern of rest. Exodus 16:30, so the people rested on the seventh day. Exodus 23:12, 6 days shall thou do thy work, and on the seventh day thou shalt rest, that thine ox and thine ass may rest, and the son of thine handmaid and the stranger may be refreshed. Mark 6:31, and he said unto them, come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest a while, for there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat. In a lot of ways, it's no wonder that America is the most depressed country on earth. We so often violate God's command at giving our body rest. In doing so, we either get depressed or run our families into depression, like the preacher who used to enjoy saying, there's no rest for the wicked and the righteous don't need any, until his wife had a nervous breakdown and he thought better of that. If you feel depression coming on, a day off may be a good start. Try sleeping in, then getting up and going outside without your smartphone, and spending some time in a chair in the sunshine soaking up some vitamin D. Norwegian study found some things out about that. There's a correlation between vitamin D deficiency and depression, and the body does not naturally produce vitamin D2, but the sun produces it in the body when it's exposed to the sun. So go outside now and then, or even better, try my favorite concoction of rest-based medication, sand, sun, sea. I call it toes in the sand therapy. My very favorite. If you get exhausted, you'll get overwhelmed. If you get overwhelmed, you'll get depressed. Rest and then learn to be in the habit of resting before that happens. What we do is we run ourselves ragged and then start thinking, you know, maybe I ought to get some rest. Well, maybe we could refine that system. You think, Brother Paul? Maybe before we run ourselves ragged, get some rest before the depression sets in. Number two, when Elijah was battling depression, he got some good nourishment. Look at verse 5-7. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water at his head. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Twice Elijah was fed a good meal. No preservatives, no junk food, nothing unhealthy. Did you realize our body takes the nourishment we give it and converts it into chemicals that we need to function? It's no wonder that people are often depressed. Liver mush and grease biscuit for breakfast, Big Mac combo for lunch, bag of potato chips and soda for supper week after week. You talk about a recipe for depression. Now, please understand that there are no magic foods that cure depression. It's that eating poorly wrecks your physical condition, and depression is a logical result. Many times when we're helping people through depression, we take them out to eat somewhere, not just to get them out in the sunshine, but also to get them some vegetables and some healthy things they haven't had for a while. Listen, the body responds to when things start moving in the right direction, and when the body responds, you're moving in the right direction to help with the symptoms of depression. Americans are often guilty of eating their way into depression by wrecking their physical condition with the junk they eat. We call it digging your grave with a spoon. But if you can eat your way into that condition with the wrong food, you can at least start the process of eating your way out with the right food. Number 3, verse 8, when Elijah was battling depression, he got some good exercise. Verse 8, and he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. Now please consider this. How many of you, please don't be pious or overly humble or even embarrassed. How many of you feel like you're just a little bit out of shape and you get winded pretty easily and you wish you were in better shape than you were? Hands going up all over the place. Second question, how good of a shape do you think you'd be in if you went on a 40-day walk? Third question, how good do you think you'd feel after you stepped on the scale or looked in the mirror after that 40-day walk? Not feeling so depressed anymore, are we? But there's much more of this thing of exercise than just what we read on the scale or see in the mirror. Remember that thing of the chemical imbalance we spoke of? Exercising does a marvelous thing in regards to that. When a person exercises, their body does exactly what God designed it to do. It produces a great set of chemicals known as endorphins. There are three basic kinds that our body produces during exercise: beta endorphins, enkephalins, and dynorphin. These marvelous chemicals, when produced by the body, reduce pain, promote feelings of happiness and euphoria, help to regulate the appetite, and settle the mind. There are very few things on earth as powerful as endorphins at fixing a body chemistry and and making depression vanish like the night when the sun rises. Incidentally, these are also the exact same chemicals and chemical reactions that every antidepressant drug on earth seeks to mimic. When somebody comes into my office huffing and puffing and wheezing from the strenuous walk of 50 feet it took to get them there, it doesn't surprise me they're a little depressed. The scale depresses them, the mirror depresses them, the clothes depresses them, the fact that they have less endorphins than a Democrat has good ideas depresses them. I know all this very personally. As a pastor, I not only have to deal with my own problems and my family's problems, but with a lot of other people's problems as well. I've had days where my phone rang at 2 o'clock in the morning. Someone on the other end had problems to dump on me. Then at 7 o'clock, a text came in with more problems from others. Then I got up and came to church, and people hit me with problems right before I got up to preach. And then I got calls during lunch, and somebody needed me to stay after night service for more. And then I was awake most of the night thinking about all of it. And within a 24-hour period, Brandon, I was depressed. And then I get up on Monday morning, the dreaded Monday morning, drag myself to the gym, lay down on a bench, the porter lifts some heavy weights for a while, thinking, what's the use? And after about an hour, hour and a half, I felt completely different. Radically different. Very good friend of mine weighed in at 220 pounds and was clinically depressed, diagnosed as such, on antidepressants and still nearly suicidal despite the meds. And then he tried something different. He started by walking every single day. And then as the weight started to come off, he started running every single day. Then he got to liking the way running felt, and he started running marathons. And now he weighs 160, isn't on antidepressants anymore. Every day he gets what's called runner's high, which produces feelings of euphoria and reduced anxiety. For him, his depression was rooted in his poor physical condition, and it was completely solved by moving his feet. Say, preacher, I'm old. I can't do very much. Can you move anything? If you can move your arms, you can do something. If you can move your legs, you can do something. I will never forget going to see Brother Cecil in the nursing home, so discouraged over being there and wanted to get out so desperately. But every time they told him to pick up a 3-pound weight, he'd pick up a 5-pound weight. And every time they told him to do 15 reps, he'd do 30 and 40 and 50 reps. And he's beaming at 91 years old from ear to ear because he feels so much better from what he's done. In dealing with depression, deal as much as possible with the physical and behavioral causes that make the body not operate the way God designed it. Then secondly, when dealing with depression, deal also with the spiritual, emotional, and relational causes that contribute to depression. Number one, when Elijah was battling depression, he came to where God was. Look at verse 8. And he arose and did eat and drink, and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. If you know anything about your Bible, you know that Horeb was where Moses met God in the burning bush. Horeb was where God gave millions of Jews water from the rock. Horeb's where God made a covenant with Israel. Elijah knew if he went there, he could meet with God. When a person that's depressed runs the opposite way from where they can meet with God, they'll likely stay depressed and it'll likely get worse. When a person who's depressed runs toward God as hard as they can, the exact opposite will likely be true. That's why lost people often have to be medicated. They've never met God. They don't know Him. He doesn't dwell in their heart. The lost person does not have what God can give to fix depression or alleviate it. What is that? Well, first of all, there's the peace that passes understanding. Philippians 4, 6, and 7 says, "Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." Paul said, God will give you peace that passes understanding. Oh, that's easy for him to say. He was a preacher, probably only worked 3 days a week and was behind a desk when he said it. No, he was in prison when he said it. Talk about credibility. He was in prison when he said it and said, God can give me the peace that passes understanding. The circumstances weren't good, but he had peace that passes understanding. This is what Jesus can give. If you're depressed, meet with God. So very much of people's depression stems from circumstances in their lives, doesn't it? There's a thing often that causes it. Not always, but often there's a thing that causes it. But if you have a God that can give you peace that transcends those circumstances, you need to run toward Him, especially during times of depression. Here's another thing that God can give to deal with depression, the pardon from sin. Isaiah 55, 7, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and He will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for He will abundantly pardon." Not always, But sometimes depression is caused by sin in our lives. Sin has a way of breaking things, making things complicated, making situations seem overwhelming, especially, listen carefully, especially sins like unforgiveness and bitterness, which eat us alive while we cling to them tightly like a teddy bear we can't bear to part with. If you're harboring those sins, you're not going to make the people you're angry at depressed, but you will make you depressed. It's for your own good that you ought to quickly and fully forgive. Going to meet with God, confessing and forsaking sin, removing that guilt from the equation can make all the difference in the world. If you're depressed and there's a sin at the root of it, go meet with God, confess and forsake that sin, and things will change dramatically. Young couple came to see a pastor friend of mine. They were both depressed and, by their own words, suicidal. You see, she'd gotten pregnant and had had an abortion. The young man had grown up in my friend's church, and he knew how guilty he was because he's the one that pressured her to have the abortion. My pastor friend talked to them. She knelt down and asked for forgiveness and asked to be saved. He knelt down and asked for forgiveness and asked God to restore him to a right fellowship. When they lifted their head, her eyes got really wide, and she said, "It's gone. It's gone. The guilt is gone." And she felt completely different leaving than she did coming in. Listen, if you're depressed and there's sin at the root of it, go meet with God. Confess and forsake that sin. Things will change dramatically. Here's another thing that God can give us to deal with depression. That's the promise that He will never leave us nor forsake us. Hebrews 13:5, "Let your conversation be without covetousness and be content with such things as you have. For He has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee." A great deal of depression stems from the feeling of being alone, doesn't it? But when you cultivate a walk with God, when you understand that He will never leave you and that He's right there with you, that dynamic can change dramatically. If you've ever experienced those moments where you were having the hardest time of your life and all of a sudden it's like somebody else was there beside you, there's a reason. Somebody else was there beside you. He said, "I'll never leave you nor forsake you." All this is about coming to where God is. Getting Him to give you the things that only He can give you and allowing those things to combat your depression. Without all these things, it's no wonder the lost person gets depressed. And when a Christian does not keep very close to God, it's no wonder that they get depressed also. John 15:4-5, Jesus said, "Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself except that abide in me, branch cannot bear fruit of itself except that abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing." When a Christian's battling depression, one of the first things I do is inquire how their walk with God is going. When a lost person comes battling depression, I try at some point to win them to God. It's all about getting close to God either way. Christian, where do you go to meet God? Well, the obvious first answer is His house. The devil's very good at what he does, isn't he? He's no slacker. He's been at it a long time. We're often foolish in the decisions we make helping him out. A Christian will begin battling depression, and the very first thing they do is listen to the whispers of the devil and get out of church. And yet that time of worship together with brothers and sisters in Christ is often the very medicine needed to begin combating that depression and allowing the sun to shine in your heart again. Another answer is in His Word and in prayer, our personal devotion time. Hear me, if you are not regularly, daily spending time with God by reading His Word and praying, you are leaving the door wide open for depression. God is forever meeting with people in the page of Scripture and at the throne room of grace. I cannot count the number of times I have been really discouraged and in almost desperation reached for the Bible, flipped it open at random because I did not know where to go at that moment, looked down to the page and saw exactly what I needed to see to help snap me out of it. If you're battling depression, you need to be meeting with God very regularly. Number two, when Elijah was battling depression, God corrected his wrong perception of reality. Look at verse 14. Notice what Elijah said. He said, "I've been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with a sword, and I only am left, and they seek my life to take it away." So according to Elijah, who's the only one left? Just him. How many is that? It's one. Look at verse 18. God said, "Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, and every mouth which hath not kissed him." Isn't there sort of a discrepancy between 1 and 7,000? Big discrepancy. The person battling depression will very rarely have the right view of reality. If they're facing a molehill, it'll look like a mountain. If they're facing a mountain, it'll look like a mountain range. They'll normally focus exclusively on the problem and ignore the blessings altogether. A depressed person needs to do a very good inventory and see just how blessed they are and how very good God has been to them. A person living under a delusion will not get out of their depression. When somebody comes battling depression, I normally would do something really simple. I'll hand them a blank piece of paper and a pen, and I'll say, write these words. They'll start to write as I say, Mom, Dad, kids, brother, sister, house, car, sight, hearing, the ability to walk, sense of smell, freedom, the Bible, salvation, heaven, and on and on and on. What I'm pointing out is how very blessed most depressed people are. If you're battling depression, you need to do an inventory. Another thing you need to do, a discipline you need to develop is this. When you begin to feel discouragement or depression overwhelming you, you need to either in your mind or on paper, whichever way works best for you, actually identify the source or sources as fully as you can. Now understand, sometimes there will be times where there's really no one source and you can't figure it out. That's one of the classical marks of certain types of depression. But a lot of times, it's actually circumstance-based, and sometimes it's not even what you think. There's a lot of times, Matt, I'll be driving down the road and I realize I am in a funk. I mean a bad funk. I mean, not sure if I want to like run the car off the road or stop and hit somebody. Just not sure. I'm just this horrible funk. And I think, why am I like this? What happened? And I'll stop and think. A lot of times it's, oh yeah, 5 minutes ago I was listening to the radio and there was that news story out of Washington, and all of a sudden I'm nosediving again, and I have to realize, wait a minute, okay, God's still in control of that. God's still in control of that. It's going to be okay. Sometimes I'll go back to it and I'll think, okay, wait a minute, I had a disagreement with so-and-so and so-and-so. Okay, but look, I had disagreements before. It's going to be okay. God can handle that. I'm going to send him a text. Tell him I love him. You're identifying the problem, because what you identify makes it more real and easy to wrap your mind around. In verse 14, Elijah said, I'm the only one. Verse 18, God said, no, you're not the only one. There are 7,000 others. Never, ever allow the devil or your mind to make things one bit worse than they actually are. Be in the habit of taking the discipline to identify any triggers. Then number three, when Elijah was battling depression, God turned his focus away from himself and his pity party and made him go serve others. Verse 15, and the Lord said unto him, go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi shall thou anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah shall thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. There are very few things as powerful for curing depression as for going out and serving others. It's hard to be down when you're wheeling an old person into an activity room for a nursing home service. Hard to be down when you're tending to the fatherless and ministering to widows. The more a person focuses on self, the more prone they'll be to get depressed. So when a person's depressed, they need to do something very counterintuitive. The depressed person is looking inward. It's all about me and what I'm going through. But if you really want to get out of it, you'll flip that focus around and you'll start looking outward for a way you can help others. Everybody needs a reason to live, and everybody can have one if they want it. So years ago in the old building, there was a lady that came, and Dana and I went to see her the next week. We got to her little trailer. She lived in a neat-looking little trailer park, cute as a pin, and we knocked on the door. Didn't think anybody was home because I didn't see the lights, and presently, the door opened. And the lady was there in the door, but there's like almost no light behind her. It's the most eerie thing I'd ever seen. Come on in. We went inside, and there's like, I'm not kidding, one little like 6-watt candelabra bulb in the entire place. And all the shades are pulled. It was like she was having a seance or something. I mean, it was dark. I was thinking, why don't you open the curtains around here? And we sat down, and hey, you came to see us Sunday, and we just wanted to come visit you, see how you're doing. I'm not good. That's okay. Well, what can we do for you? And she began to unleash a tale of woe and discouragement and depression. And it was me. And I knew what could help her. I said, when she finally took a breath, I said, ma'am, I have some questions for you. When's the last time you ever picked up your phone and called somebody and said, I didn't need anything. I just wanted you to know I was thinking about you and I'm praying for you today. And she said, nobody ever calls me and does that. I said, okay, let's try again. When's the last time you ever got a card, a lovely card, and wrote out a card and sent the card to somebody that says, hey, I want to let you know I love you, thinking for you, wanted to brighten your day, you're special and important to me. And she said, nobody ever sends me cards like that. I'm sorry, we're going to try one more time. When's the last time, I see you in this lovely little trailer park here, when's the last time you ever made a cake for somebody, one of your neighbors, walked and knocked up their door, and when they came, said, this wasn't for any particular reason, I just wanted to make you a cake to brighten your day. She said, nobody ever makes me a cake like that. I said, ma'am, faith is a great trait. I didn't. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. There was nothing we could do to help her, literally. Because it was all an inward focus. Listen to me. If you really want to get out of your depression, then I'm telling you, you're going to have to turn that focus outward. Because there are other people that need help. And when you help others, it's like the most cathartic drug you've ever got in your life. There's nothing that feels as good as helping others. Number four, when Elijah was battling depression, God showed him the future. Hang with me on this. Look at verse 17. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. There were some wicked people that needed to be judged, and God showed Elijah that in the future it was going to happen. You know, when a person is battling depression, it's like they have a dark cloud hanging over their head all the time. But if you could take your Bible and show them what the future is like, especially for a child of God, it would change some things. Can I tell you what the future's like? 1 Thessalonians 4:16 and 17. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Jesus is coming, and we get to be reunited with everybody that's ever saved that we've lost along the way. Says the same thing in 1 Corinthians 15:51-54. Says the same thing pretty much in Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 through 19, and it adds the fact that the Lord is going to clean house and he is going to deal with everybody that's ever done anything against him. What a future. But you might also want to remember that we serve a God who can give us a great future, not just in the sweet by and by, but also in the wonderful now and now. Job, no doubt, had a lot of moments of depression, and yet look how his story ended. Joseph, no doubt, had a lot of moments of depression. Look how his story ended. Listen, your future might not be as bleak as you think it is. You've got a God that's able. When Elijah was battling depression, God also directed him to godly companionship. Look at verse 16 again. And Jehu the son of Nimshi shall thou anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat, son of Abel-Meholah, shall thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. Verse 19. So he departed thence and found Elisha the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him, and he with the 12th, and Elijah passed by him and cast his mantle upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he said unto him, go back again. What have I done to thee? And he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen and slew them and boiled their flesh with the instruments of the oxen and gave unto the people, and they did eat. Then he arose and went after Elijah and ministered unto him. From this point forward, Elijah and Elisha had godly companionship together. Listen to me. Loneliness is the ally of depression. Companionship is the enemy of depression. Say that again. Loneliness is the ally of depression. Companionship is the enemy of depression. Understand this fully, though. The relationship was not one where Elijah was weak and needy and whiny and expected Elisha to make him feel better all the time. Elisha did minister to Elijah, but the truth is that Elijah poured his life into Elisha. Elijah took Elisha from being a farm boy and made a prophet out of him. In other words, Elijah, far from whining that he didn't have any friends, went out and befriended somebody. There are people everywhere that need friends, and it's fairly simple to make friends out of them. Proverbs 18:24, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. You never again read of Elijah going into a depression, partially because he spent the rest of his life being a friend to somebody. Companionship's the enemy of depression. When Jesus went into the Garden of Gethsemane, do you remember what he said? My soul is exceeding sorrowful even unto death. But the next words out of his mouth were, tarry ye here and watch with me. Why did he say that? Because he brought some men with him. You getting this? The Son of God, in his most depressing hour, leaned on the friendship of others. Isn't that amazing? Don't ever cut yourself off from others in the midst of depression. Be in Sunday school. Be in Sunday morning. Be in Sunday night. Be in Wednesday night. Be in revival meetings. Go to fellowship with people. Go out and have meals with people. Go on activities with friends. Companionship is the enemy of depression. Then the third thing, when dealing with depression, just keep breathing a while longer. Look at verse 4. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he requested for himself that he might die, and said, it's enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm not better than my fathers. Verse 21, and he returned back from him and took a yoke of oxen and slew them and boiled their flesh with the instruments of the oxen, gave unto the people, and they did eat. Then he arose and went after Elijah and ministered unto him. Verse 4, he's saying, I'm not going another step. I'm going to quit right here. Verse 21, he is going on and still breathing and still functioning and still living. When Dana and I got certified for our scuba licenses several years ago, there was a rule they taught us immediately before we ever got in the water, and that is just keep breathing. Just keep breathing. They said, all you need is air. Just keep breathing. All you need is air. Just keep breathing. I love being underwater. If there was such a thing as reincarnation, I could come back as a fish and be happy. Dana is claustrophobic, so she got a little bit nervous under there. We were 30 feet down, and I felt her digging into my arm, hanging on to me. And then I felt her relax a little bit, and I saw her start to take some nice, smooth, slow breaths, and I knew what she was thinking. Just keep breathing. All I need is air. Just keep breathing. All I need is air. What did Elijah do? Well, he just kept breathing. What did Job do? He just kept breathing. What did Jeremiah do when he was suicidally depressed almost? He just kept breathing. Psalm 27:13 says, I had fainted unless I'd believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Are we looking forward to heaven? But the psalmist said we can look forward to the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Listen to me real carefully. Time may not heal all wounds, but it sure heals a lot of them. And you don't know if you quit breathing. You don't know if you stop. You don't know if you give up. Just go another day. And then another day. And then another day. And then another day. Back in Moab, there was a girl that I guarantee you was depressed. Man, she'd lost her husband. And on top of that, she'd been childless for 10 years. Then her mother-in-law decided to move away. Ruth decided not to quit. Decided to keep on breathing. Matter of fact, she went back to Bethlehem with her mother-in-law. Lo and behold, when she'd been told there was no hope, there was some hope. There was a guy there that even Naomi didn't know about. Man, the name of Boaz. She got married. And then this girl that had gone for 10 years without kids and just knew she'd never be able to have one, all of a sudden she had a child. Listen to me. Just keep breathing. Don't ever quit. Just keep breathing. Is it possible you can do all this and still end up needing medication or counseling? Sure it is. And if that's the case, there's no shame in all that. Get your help, whatever you need. But all these things I brought out in this text brought Elijah the victory. They brought a lot of others victory as well. I'm telling you something. You have a little more control over things normally than you think you do. Even this. Is this a monster? Yeah. Has it taken out a lot of people? Yeah. Does it have to take out you? No. No, it doesn't. You can beat this. You can defeat depression.